Good morning. I'd like to start by thank you all for coming to the plenary session on intersectionality as a research approach to understanding and promoting resilience and responsiveness in health systems. I'm Daniel Reedpath. I'm Professor of Population Health at Monash University, Malaysia, and I have the pleasure of chairing this session. In yesterday's plenary, the idea was developed that systems and people can have multiple vulnerabilities. This notion of multiple vulnerabilities at an individual, population, and systems level leads naturally into a discussion of intersectionality. We would argue that the ideas you will hear today are necessarily a part of developing research for resilient and responsive health systems. More significantly, we think the ideas to be presented today need to be aired widely, discussed and debated thoughtfully, and ultimately used. And we appreciate the fact that you chose to be here and not to sneak an extra hour's sleep, a leisurely breakfast, or a side meeting. The Sustainable Development Goals, which replaced the Millennium Development Goals, have a clear equity agenda of leaving no one behind. In the context of health systems, this ideal is probably best encapsulated in the notion of universal health coverage. The question necessarily arises from these two ideas, however, is what do we mean by no one, as in leave no one behind, and what do we mean by universal, as in universal health coverage? A little over a decade, some colleagues and I were interested in how one creates the limits to community, how one defines no one to mean that you could leave some people behind but not others, and how you could define universal so it didn't quite include everyone. We started with an idea proposed by the political theorist Michael Walzer in his 1981 article, The Distribution of Membership. And he wrote, "The primary good we distribute to one another is membership in some human community. And what we do with regard to membership structures all our other distributive choices. It determines with whom we make those choices and to whom we allocate goods and services. And the goods and services that we're interested in here today are those that relate to health systems. Who can access health services? What services can they access? What rules govern that access? And what are the structural factors that delineate community and impede or enhance utilization? In our work, we identified some very clear strategies for legitimizing the marginalization of groups based on a range of attributes from gender, sexual orientation, and poverty, through to health status, geography, and religion. In fact, just about any characteristic you care to name could be used to legitimize marginalization. And the characteristics can layer or intersect. The obverse of marginalization, of course, is that the rules of inclusion and access are also there. Our article appeared over a decade ago in Sociology of Health and Illness. It has more recently found a new audience among a class of rising stars in the firmament of applied political science. Among the most famous readers are Vladimir Putin, Rodrigo Duterte, Narendra Modi, and most recently and most famously, Donald J. Trump. These are people who have used identity politics to squeeze, mold, and shift the envelope of community, redefining politically who is in and who is out, and how broad and inclusive the umbrella of community may be. The applied political scientists' use of these ideas provide highly visible examples of the way power, resources, and access are distributed or withheld according to rules of inclusion and exclusion. They can be applied to a wide range of social goods and services, including health services. Attributes of entitlement or restriction are not simple binaries, but interplay and intersect. In this plenary, we will have three speakers and two discussants. They are followed, I hope, with some lively discussion with questions from the floor. We had anticipated that we would use Twitter as one of the ways of taking questions from the floor, and while it is not 3 a.m. and we do trust you with your accounts, the technology unfortunately won't support it. Each of the speakers will present for 10 minutes, and each discussant will respond to the ideas raised for 5 minutes. The first speaker is Elena Hankiewski. Elena is the director of the Institute for Intersectionality Research and Policy at Simon Fraser University and a professor in the School of Public Policy, and a former Canadian Institutes of Health Research, Gender and Health Research Chair, and a Michael Smith Foundation for Health Research Senior Scholar. She is one of the leading thinkers in the area of intersectionality, and will provide the background to our discussions. The second speaker is Sundari Ravindran. Sundari has a PhD in applied economics from the Center for Development Studies in Trivandrum, Kerala, in India,
and is currently a professor at the Achuta Menon Center for Health Sciences Studies in Trivandrum. Her work has concentrated on gender and marginalization, and she will give some examples from her research using intersectionality as an approach. The third and final speaker is Saira Shamim. Saira is the UNFPA Country Office Head in Malaysia. Saira has been working in the field of human rights, women's rights, and the right to health for the last 27 years in various capacities spanning community mobilization, public education, organizational development, advocacy, as well as national and international policy development. Saira's talk uses a marginalized community in East Malaysia to consider the application of intersectionality from an institutional and structural standpoint. The first discussant is Asha George. Asha is the South African Research Chair in Health Systems, Complexity and Social Change at the University of Western Cape. She is a qualitative researcher engaged with health systems to advance health and social justice in low and middle income countries. Using a gender rights lens, she focuses on the frontline interface and governance of services, taking into consideration community engagement and health worker perspectives. The second and final discussant is Jean-Frédéric Levesque. Jean-Frédéric is the Chief Executive of the New South Wales Bureau of Health Information in Australia and a member of the Strategic Analytic Advisory Committee of the Canadian Institute of Health Information. He has acted in healthcare systems performance measurement roles in Australia and Canada and conducted research on access to healthcare and various models of primary healthcare services in Australia, Canada, USA, and India. And now please join me in welcoming our first speaker to the podium, Elena Hankiewski.
Thank you very much. Well, my task today is threefold. It's to set the stage for you, it's to bring a certain simplicity to the complexity of the framework of intersectionality, and also to start to build a case for why it is such a promising approach. So let me begin with the question, why intersectionality? In current times, the case for intersectionality is really relatively easy to make. We just need to consider for a moment the world in which we now live in. Increasing movement of people, increasingly diverse populations, an increasingly interdependent world, persistent inequalities between and within countries, persistent weaknesses and biases within healthcare systems, better recognition of the health damaging effects of discrimination. And I would just add, we only have to look at the recent events like Brexit and the US elections to see why they call out so much for an intersectionality analysis and its absolute focus on different forms of discrimination and processes of power. I would also argue that there's a growing awareness that existing approaches and tools are inadequate for transforming the status quo. And here I would actually include social determinants of health approaches. And as Daniel had mentioned, we also have the emergence of the SDG agenda and the principle of leaving no one behind, which really brings to the fore the importance of understanding intersecting inequalities for capturing the experiences of vulnerable populations. There have been many attempts to define intersectionality, and I thought I would start with some actual pictorial metaphors. We've had people propose traffic intersections, Kimberly Crenshaw looking at intersecting roads of oppression. Another example would be the compounding composition of a fly's eye. The interconnecting swirls of a marble, the dynamic reflections of a kaleidoscope, among others. But what kind of definition can we give to intersectionality? There have been many definitions in the literature, and this is just but one. It's historically rooted in Black feminist theory and scholarship, but officially coined by the Black feminist legal scholar Kimberly Crenshaw in 1989. It's burgeoning across all disciplines, including most recently in health. So one possible definition is intersectionality promotes an understanding of human beings as shaped by the intersections, interactions of different social locations, sex, race, ethnicity, indigeneity, gender, class, sexuality, geography, age, disability, ability, migration status, religion. These interactions occur within a context of connected systems and structures of power, and through such processes, interdependent forms of privilege and oppression are created. So that is a mouthful. It's very complex. How can we put this simply when thinking about health? Health status, health inequities, health needs are never the result of singular, distinct, explanatory factors, but the outcome of intersections of different factors, power relations, and experiences. I want to underscore, intersectional is not intersectoral. It is very different. Intersectoral might be the actual application of a multi-level analysis that's required by intersectionality, but it is not intersectoral. How can we distill intersectionality then into a number of central tenets? Here are a few. Human lives cannot be reduced to single categories, such as gender, such as socioeconomic status, such as race or ethnicity. The importance of any social location can never be predetermined, but happens in the process of investigation and discovery. Categories and social locations are linked, and that doesn't mean we simply add them up together, but we look at the dynamic relationships between them. Categories are not coherent, but fluid in their meaning. Multi-level analysis that link individual experiences to broader structures and processes across time and across space are key to understanding power. Further, privilege and penalty are simultaneously experienced, so we need to move away from the binary of you're either equal or you're not. It changes. It's very fluid. We also require self-reflexivity by scholars, researchers, and policy actors and activists who engage in the doing of intersectionality, thinking about one's own intersecting social locations, position of power, and how that influences what we look at, what we think is important, how we approach it, how we collect data, how we analyze data, and then how we translate that data as well. And finally, and this is very important, intersectionality informed research, policy, and practice must be informed by social justice and a commitment to transformation. It's not just about describing or documenting, it's about concrete change. And that requires building coalitions, building alliances, working across lines that might feel quite counterintuitive in order to make change. People often say, well, intersectionality is very complex. What are the methods and what is the guidance that's available to us? I would say this is absolutely no longer an issue. We have a plethora of research that gives us normative and operational guidance. And this includes qualitative examples, quantitative examples, mixed methods examples, and policy-related examples. We also have a range of social justice praxis guidance for community organizations, NGOs, international bodies, and those engaged with human rights. My Institute for Intersectionality Research and Policy at Simon Fraser University has been very engaged in trying to apply intersectionality to all forms of research and policy. We have a number of guides that I would encourage you to look at if you're wanting further guidance. But what I really want to say is what we've learned in all this work is that intersectionality is not prescriptive. It's not about checklists or following a certain set of questions. It's about bringing a certain set of values and ideas and principles to one's work. And the principles that we've identified and that we use very often are these in the pie chart. And they very much relate to the earlier definition I presented and the key tenets that I outlined for you. And those include a commitment to social justice and equity, paying attention to resilience when we interrogate power or people's position of advantage or disadvantage, being attentive to intersecting categories and how they shape human experience, engaging in a multi-level analysis, so always linking that individual level experience to the macro processes of power that shape them, and of course, placing power central to the analysis, engaging in reflexivity about what we bring to our own work, and then obviously really being attentive to time and space to look at different experiences across different country contexts and populations. So this is just to say that what really matters is not a particular way to conduct research or to do policy analysis, but it's to bring to the work what can be referred to as an intersectionality-informed stance. It's about being attentive to those principles when doing research, when evaluating, when developing, when implementing, when monitoring, when making change, and really to explore counterintuitive solutions and always being committed to that goal of social justice. And finally, I hope that as the speakers after me will show you and demonstrate that intersectionality has great, great empirical validity. I want to say that at the most basic level, it really does resonate with the common sense recognition that people's experiences are influenced by a multitude of factors, and that the interactions of those factors can lead to experiences of discrimination and disadvantage and profoundly affect people's chances and opportunities. So what this means in terms of practical applications is that intersectionality illuminates that human lives are embedded in multiple contexts, historic contexts, cumulative contexts, interlocking contexts. It has the power to change how problems and phenomena are approached and analyzed. It can provide us with greater insights into systems of marginalization, oppression, and privilege. It can generate more precise information for the delivery of responsive, effective, efficient health systems and services. And finally, it can empower citizens and provide them with different ways to organize and advance resilience, innovative alliances, and strategies. Thank you.
I think Elena did an amazing job of encapsulating a career's research into 10 minutes so that we can try and keep up with it. I'd like to invite Sundari Ravindran to take on the next role.
Good morning. With Elena having laid out the landscape of what it means to do intersectional research, I'm here today to share with you some examples that could make it probably a bit more concrete in terms of what does it mean to do research with an intersectional lens and in the field of public health. So I'm first going to talk about the value added of an intersectionality lens and give two examples of work by other colleagues. One, using quantitative methods, and another using qualitative methods, and then share with you some reflections of what then this brings to public health research and specifically health equity research. The first, so what does an intersectionality lens bring to health systems research? One, I would say it unmasks assumptions of within-group homogeneity. I'll give you examples for many of these. In the work that I've seen done, we all know that the incidence of suicides is much higher among men than among women. But further analysis in the context of Kerala, where I live, showed that women in the 15 to 24 age group experienced a much higher incidence of suicides than men did. And had we not looked at the angle of women across different age groups, which means different dispositions of power, we would not understand that. Second, it reveals the true extent of the health gaps. Here again, another example. So we look at, is there discrimination by gender in use of health services? We look at boys versus girls, and we find, yeah, not very significant. And then we look at, what about sex and birth order? And then you find the first order born boy and fourth or fifth order born girl, and the gap widens. And then you say, what about those from better off families and from low income families? And then you find the gap is as wide as that. So you're going to underestimate those gaps unless you took that intersectional perspective. There seems to be a notion that intersectionality is about everyone who is minus, minus, minus. I mean, it's that the most marginalized groups. But in fact, it isn't. It is about everybody across that spectrum and an attempt to understand why they are, where they are, and what happens when somebody has some privileges and some disadvantages. What about a poor male? What about a non-poor female? What happens to them? Olena talked about the centrality of power. And so, you know, I mean, students usually ask you, if there are so many categories, how am I going to decide which ones to take? This is mind-boggling. And I think that's where context specificity comes. And the key question is, what are the power dynamics causing the gaps? What is relevant in this particular context? And that's about, you know, how power is distributed there across different axes. And then the other concept is of mutually constituting nature of inequalities. You often see in intersectionality literature that it's not all additive. Let me give you one example of, you say, a woman from a poor household and a woman from a non-poor household. Gender is not constructed the same way in each of these. For a woman in a poor household, having to work may be oppression. For a woman in a non-poor household, getting the mobility and the cash on hand through work could be a very positive thing. So gender and class could mutually constitute each other, gender, class, ethnicity, and so on. Let me come immediately to one of the examples. The colleague who's done this is in this audience, I think. This is a study done in India about who gains, who loses, and how, leveraging gender and class intersection to secure health entitlements. The study examines the leveraging that occurs among groups which lie in the middle, as groups use their advantages along some dimensions to compensate for disadvantages along others. And this study examined access to health entitlements by men and women across three income classes, poorest, poor, and non-poor groups. I'm not getting into the methodology here. Google and you will find some innovative methodology of doing quantitative intersectional research. What did they find? Advantage male gender. So poor men leveraged gender to counter their class disadvantages. And they had almost similar odds of beginning treatment, which was one outcome, and continuing treatment as non-poor men by cornering resources within the home and borrowing and selling assets to mobilize funds. Not only poor men, women, but even non-poor women could not access household resources in a similar way. Non-poor women drew upon their class endowment to buffer their gender disadvantage, but only once they started treatment, they could continue treatment. But a large proportion did not begin treatment because they did not acknowledge the need for treatment, even though it caused difficulties in work for a median of 1 to 3 years. They were quite sick, but they didn't feel entitled. So internalized gender norms despite class advantages, tilted the balance in a different way. So without intersectionality lens, we would have, if we had focused only on class differences, we would have looked at all the poor as same, and it would have masked the disproportionate disadvantages experienced by the poor and poorest women, but more importantly, completely overlooked the disadvantages of non-poor women. And there are major policy implications for this. Look at the social health security schemes, which are aimed at poor households, forgetting the within household dynamics where the men may corner the resources. Here, I'm going to focus on the methodology that a colleague had used about in her study on Dalit women securing livelihood entitlements in South India. This study was looking at Dalit women, women in the lowest rung of the caste hierarchy in two contexts in South India, one a peri-urban and a rural one. And she used exploratory, contextual, and experiential research methods, living within the communities, doing non-participant observation, in-depth interviews, and so on, to understand which groups of Dalit women, one in a peri-urban setting and one in a rural setting, were able to leverage which kinds of advantages in order to be able to A, access employment in a export promotion zone, B, to leverage access to land. So she chose multiple techniques to uncover complexity of interlocking axes. Was very explicit that she chose to study only women, not men, and what were the limitations of those. However, the most interesting thing was that she looked at multiple axes within the group of Dalit women by age, marital status, in fact, education, and participation in women's groups. Each of these things helped them leverage particular advantages, and this kind of research for her was of a transformatory nature, because by finding out how even among the most marginalized, there were possibilities of leveraging power and use advantages to their betterment. Finally, what do these examples tell us? To begin with, that intersectionality research can be done, has been done. It offers a more nuanced lens through which to understand the forces underlying pervasive inequities. Methodological innovations that draw on multiple disciplines, a view from lived experiences and lay knowledge would help you understand much better the context-specific nature of those intersections. And to finally say, yes, research for social change, purposeful research of a transformational nature in terms of how and for what and with whom we do research. Thank you.
Sundari did a wonderful job of pulling out the minus problem with intersectionality and explaining how it is not just about that. Now I'd like to invite Saira Shamim to come up and talk about her reflections on intersectionality.
Okay. Good morning, and thank you for having me here today. I'm going to be sharing the experience of UNFPA Malaysia in applying intersectionality to respond to the sexual and reproductive health needs of an indigenous group called the Bajau Laut, or the Sea Gypsies. I hope that one day, as part of the seafaring First Peoples of Southeast Asia, that the Bajau Laut will eventually enjoy the respect, recognition, and efforts at reconciliation that has been shown to the First Peoples of Vancouver. I'd like to begin with a familiar development challenge allegory, that of the abandoned baby floating downriver. Of course, not just one baby, but several over time that eventually triggers a development response. The immediacy of the situation being what it is, the right response is invariably to save those babies. However, the focus is often not only on saving babies from drowning, but on the necessary adoption, education, health, cultural, and citizenship rights of those abandoned children. In reality, the emphasis on downstream results, or the outputs that are in our control, is reinforced by the language that we use, such as aiming for the low-hanging fruit or quick wins, as well as the many quantifiable indicators that are clearly focused on downstream achievements. Meanwhile, an enterprising development organization innovates a new fundraising strategy by launching a live-action primetime TV show called Babe Watch, which of course raises a lot of money. But the point here really is that donor money is more easily raised for quantifiable downstream investments, which reinforces the focus even further, while at the same time making the process of shifting the response upstream more difficult. Of course, the proverbial solution to this allegory is one we can anticipate, which is perhaps a need for some contraception upstream or other relevant response that would prevent the problem at its source. But times are changing. Typically, what development organizations are used to seeing upstream are situations of poverty or other types of resource constraints. But increasingly, in the middle-income country context, this is what you see upstream. Malaysia has excellent aggregate indicators, some of which were achieved even prior to the MDGs. In fact, Malaysia is expected to achieve high-income country status by 2020 or soon after. Development assistance from the UN system either reduces or ceases after GNI per capita exceeds $12,500. Not only are the general human development indicators already advanced, such as the MMR and IMR, but enrollment figures of women at institutions of higher education has surpassed 60%. Of the remaining challenges, like adolescent birth rates, the capacity to respond is very high in country, as you can see, where there has been a 23% decrease in the number of adolescent births in just over 2 years. In order to find the problems that persist despite the performance at aggregate level, we need to look a little closer. So in 2015, UNFPA conducted a survey of 17 marginalized communities, one of which was the Bajau Laut. They are currently without citizenship documentation, partly because of their mobility and geographic location that spans the borders of three countries, including Malaysia, Indonesia, and the Philippines. In this particular community of 20,000 people, we found that parity was between 5 to 18 children per woman, and that most girls were married by the time that they were 12. The girl in the photo is the mother of the child that she is carrying, while the other two next to her are her siblings. This is the region that this community lives in. These are the houses, which are periodically damaged or destroyed during the annual monsoon season. And as you can see, their boats are much sturdier, as much of the Bajau Laut life is spent on the seas, from delivering their babies to other cultural practices. Part of the challenge is that as a development organization, we are most familiar and set up to respond to what we used to see upstream, which are situations that arise as a result of acts of omission of duty bearers, spanning such things as capacity constraints, budget restrictions that are either internally or externally imposed, infrastructure constraints, social, economic, and political or environmental instability, or a lack of awareness, education, or empowerment. However, what is often harder to address are situations that are invariably the norm the further upstream that we go, arising from acts of commission resulting in systemic discrimination, disenfranchisement, and disempowerment. This is also often outside the mandate of many development organizations that have specific downstream focus areas. And for us, our annual reporting system simply had no relevant indicators for such work. So despite these limitations, we started by shifting the policy response from stigmatization and punitive measures against the marginalized towards addressing the underlying social determinants of health. We had to be aware of and remain responsive to systemic discrimination and invest in the dismantling of these structures. Finally, we needed to focus the program on eliminating the civil, political, economic, social, and cultural barriers to universal access to sexual and reproductive health and rights. This was important because it was simply no longer enough nor acceptable to be content with pushing the few direct beneficiaries of our development assistance through the proverbial glass ceiling, because these ceilings were constantly being rebuilt. We needed to address the structural barriers. So in response to this, we developed a program assessment tool that was based on a set of existing indicators of knowledge, awareness, and practice, as well as demographic and other sexual and reproductive health indicators. And then we added new indicators which we felt would address the structural barriers of vital registration and citizenship, access to schools, food security, ownership of productive assets, access to justice, safety and security, and climate change as experienced by the Bajau Laut, particularly in the shelter that they have, their income, and their daily food intake across seasons. In a way, reflecting on Ben Ramalingam's presentation from yesterday, this was our effort at looking at the situation from the point of view of end user back. The left-hand column, the purple, of the table, I don't know if you can read it, but I've got to blow up later, of the table contains the existing indicators, while across the top are the new indicators that were selected based on a critical evaluation of a comprehensive list. Those that were finally chosen were based on the direct bearing that they had on achieving the primary indicators of interest, which were the ones in green. Meanwhile, the pink ones are the new indicators. The clear squares are proposed indicators but are not currently implemented due to strategic concerns as well as resource limitations. Moving forwards, we plan to replicate the assessment framework in 17 different marginalized communities, including women migrant workers, rural single mothers, sex workers, urban poor women, and other indigenous groups. This is in order to test not only the choice of the indicators, but to develop a scale of outcomes that could apply to different groups across various contexts. And hopefully with this approach, we will increase our development effectiveness. Thank you.
Sarah Shamim did a great job of bringing out the upstream aspects of intersectionality and how one might go about measuring outcomes that are relevant to that. I'd like to invite Asha George to begin the interesting task of responding as a discussant to the three speakers.
Thank you, Daniel. It's an honor to be here with such terrific speakers. And I'm going to respond with three examples, reflecting on what Elena said at the beginning, and Sundri, that intersectionality is not just a method or methodology, but at its heart it tries to engage with an ethos that at its heart engages with power and how it influences who we are, what we know, and what our role is in health systems. Or as rather a previous speaker yesterday said, the systems that govern and sustain health in our very complicated world. So I have three reflections in discussing. We've had a number of very engaged debates even before coming here, and I thought I'd bring three examples of how learning with this group of people, how would I apply it in the work that I do. And I'd like to make some comments related to how intersectionality affects the content of our research, the types of knowledge production we're involved in, but also more broadly, who we are as a research community. So first of all, in terms of content, if I reflect on some of the work that I've been learning about community health workers, which is there's been a huge revitalization of community health worker programs and research on community health workers, a reflection on how some of the policies we're supporting have inadvertently led to reinforcing inequalities. So reflecting on what Cyrus said about how upstream policies can also affect the populations we care about, and in this instance, how policies in our own health systems can create inequalities. Colleagues from Eduardo Mondlane University, when we were talking about the revitalization of CHW policies in Mozambique, there's been a process there of formalizing CHWs into a more partly paid cadre. A key interest in Mozambique is addressing maternal child health and maternal and newborn health, and therefore the policy had an explicit preference of including women in this new community health worker or revitalized community health worker cadre, because they were going to have to work with pregnant women, follow up with postpartum women. Early monitoring results from that program discovered the majority of this revitalized cadre, this is what was shared from colleagues from Eduardo Mondlane University, were primarily male. So although the policy intent was to recruit women, they actually found that most of the cadre initially was male. And initial discussions with community members about this, because communities were part of the selection process for community health workers, the feedback was, well, this is now a job, and men need jobs. The implication is that women can work for free. And I think that's a constant tension that we're still grappling in with community health worker programs. In Tanzania, I've learned a lot from colleagues from MUHAS, Muhimbili University, and they've been part of working with government in some of the preliminary pilots developing what should be the CHW cadre in Tanzania. And some of the early work there really looked at, in Morogoro region, where we were working with them, the driver of some of the programs are important programs. So again, a maternal and child health program. And there was these community health workers have a big load in terms of keeping track of registers. So they put as a requirement a higher education level, because keeping track of records is a very key part of their new role. So what we realized is that this higher education level then led to a very different group of community health workers, different from what was there before. You had a lot of younger people, because they're the ones who had the education level, and a mix of younger women and men. But when we talked to communities, there was an issue of acceptability. And some women in communities said, you know, why would I talk to someone who hasn't had a child, who isn't married? And younger community health workers also felt it was hard for them to talk about family planning and these issues with women who were older than them. So these are some of the issues. We also, in some of the work in trying to measure motivation and retention amongst these community health workers, we found that a lot of the younger men who were now recruited into these roles really felt that this work was below the type of education that they had. And they were sort of using it as a stopgap before they could find something else. So these are micro examples of how these policies lead to inadvertently. So I'm out of time. I was looking at Charity. I just want to reflect two minor points. I think there's a huge upsurge in community health worker research. How much of that is transformative? I found out of the huge number of increase in research articles, only two I could find use photo voice. As a very marginalized group in the health system, how is research being used to empower those actors at the bottom of the health system? And I think we have a lot to learn, and some of the discussions here have been, who are we as a research community? What are the inequalities in our research community? And 25 years after the CORED report, highlighting the inequalities amongst researchers, we're still grappling with this in a tremendous way. And I'm just going to leave you with a slide from what just came out yesterday from a conference participant, just tracking some of these realities in the conference participants from Cape Town and Beijing in our community of health systems and policy research, contrasting who are first authors and where is data collected from. And it's, for me, I'll leave this graph here for people to look at, and it's striking, the authors also said, Francophone countries were not even, they're not on this, they didn't even make it to the bar chart. So we have multiple inequalities in our research community as well, and I think if we care about resilience, learning and being relevant and building partnerships that strengthen our community, it's critical to look at these issues.
Thank you, Asha. I think Asha did a wonderful job of taking the intersectionality from a focus on the person and their health needs to a complete system in terms of both the health worker, the researcher, and has really begun to sort of draw those elements out. I'd now like to invite Jean-Frédéric to come and share his views.
Thank you, Daniel. Dear colleagues, it's a real pleasure to be here today, back in Canada. Intersectionality seems to me to be a relatively new concept, and a concept that has not yet permeated into health system monitoring nor decision making. And the presentations from my colleagues today are, however, generating new ideas, or at least questioning some of my thinking, and hopefully your thinking too. Let me highlight the salience of the concept from the perspective of someone in charge of measuring or evaluating the performance of the healthcare system in Australia, a role that I also had in Canada and to some extent through research in parts of India. Hearing the presentations today, the notion that vulnerabilities are not the result of isolated factors and that their independent assessment can mask inequities was an important realization for me. This is important because understanding that the interactions of various personal factors, some relatively fixed while others are variable and transient, enables us to redefine disadvantage and better define vulnerability. It enables us to go beyond a labeling approach where we assume that all people of a certain race or gender might experience the same disadvantages. It also enables us to uncover vulnerabilities that are contrary to general assumptions or masked by siloed approaches. This concept is also important because it forces us to put these factors into their social context and enables us to see that personal factors also requires to be at the intersection of political aspects or social policies to generate disadvantage. They don't do this on their own. This means that not all personal characteristics will consistently be a source of vulnerability, and that an attribute that is a disadvantage in one context might actually be a benefit in other places or other times. But one of the most important findings for me as a person in charge of monitoring healthcare systems is the fact that system context, in this instance the healthcare system, but it would be true of other systems such as education, for example, they also create intersections and might determine a vulnerability. Through acts of commission, health systems can create vulnerabilities by discriminating and harming certain people or contribute to stigmatization. Health systems also interact with these personal and social contexts through what they do not do for people. They can omit to intervene or respond, exclude groups through poor planning or through deficient program implementation. Applying intersectionality to the assessment of performance in health is both an opportunity and a challenge. So to conclude my remarks, let me suggest to you four aspects where it can support measurement, measuring the strength of healthcare systems, while acknowledging that creating operational measures and analytic frameworks to convey those measures to policymakers and clinicians remain to be done. So the first one relates to access to care. This is an area where intersectionality enables a better understanding of who gets excluded from care and what are the conflation of factors that generate barriers for people and ultimately unmet needs. The second one relates to appropriateness of care, comprising the provision of the right care in the right way for people. Healthcare systems might struggle to adapt their offer of services to actual needs and expectations of people with more complex problems or more difficult to treat because of their intersection of various disadvantage, but they're also less likely to be prioritized in planning exercises. The third one relates to measuring effectiveness. We need to measure the contribution of health systems to creating vulnerabilities and use their occurrence as a measure of how effective our health promotion and disease prevention policies and programs. Finally, it relates to responsiveness and resilience. Let me pause it to conclude this brief response that intersectionality is an approach that enables us to measure if systems are able to absorb unplanned shocks, but also to develop planning models that embed a broader range of factors and their complex interaction. The disadvantage of experienced by refugees is a good example. They face exclusion because of their ethnicity and gender, because of the legal and social context of the countries where they seek asylum, because of the deterioration in health that poor living conditions, social insecurity, but also poor care can generate. They are because of the fact that it is a group that is ever-changing in receiving countries, according to political conflicts and democratic openness to migration, a constant challenge, and one of the groups that potentially reveals the adaptability and the resilience of healthcare systems. Thank you.
Jean-Frédéric concludes the speakers and the discussants, and I think bringing it back into the framework of a functioning healthcare system and how one monitors that healthcare system is incredibly important to this. We're now going to move to sort of discussion and questions from the floor. I'm going to kick off with a question to the panel, but I would invite people to sort of move to the microphones if they have a burning question. And I'm going to move to the mic if I can. I think the question which has sort of been asked, but I'd like to just bring it up again because I think if you're new to the area, it's going to churn in people's heads, and it is around the social determinants. Why isn't it just social determinants all over again?
Okay, I have some ideas on this. Clearly, there are overlapping priorities between the two approaches, but I would say that there are a number of clear differences as well. First of all, when we look at a number of determinants of health frameworks, they have a finite list of factors, and that for me is quite problematic. Another thing that I think intersectionality does better than social determinants is it actually looks at the interaction of those factors that determinants of health frameworks consider. So really the complex relationships, the interactions. I sometimes think that social determinants of health frameworks look at power. They talk about power, but do they really fully integrate power in a multi-level analysis? I think that's also a question mark. So those would be three things that I would say for me makes the determinants of health framework fall short in relation to intersectionality.
Anyone else?
I think that it's a great contribution of intersectionality to actually helping us to bring back healthcare systems into this understanding of social determinants of health. It tends to be sectors that are in competition sometimes, or at least ignoring each other. And realizing that the services that are provided, the way we respond to some of those social determinants can actually either conflate the problem or alleviate really what it means in a certain context to, you know, be living in poverty or being from a certain ethnic group. So I think it's very important to see them in interaction and put back some responsibility in healthcare systems to also address them, although they're at the curative end of the spectrum.
I think it builds on and reinforces social determinants in the sense that it looks at the structural drivers that create inequalities of health. As Elena said, it's looking at the intersecting amongst marginalized populations, the strengths that they have, but also how multiple disadvantages combine. But I also think it's a really useful lens that looks at power, not just at our topic that we care about in terms of health systems, but as I said, who we are as a community. Mm-hmm. It's a principle that, and who we are as a community is a good part of how we do our research and how we engage in social change. And that way, in that sense, it's something that it is permeates more profoundly and hopefully can generate more change.
Sorry, Sundari.
I don't know if it was meant to be like that, but in the CSDH framework, the way we receive it in the world, we have a box with social positions, with categories, as if these are natural attributes of people and not the result of various processes. So there is race, ethnicity, gender, without racism, sexism, or patriarchy coming through there. And also the interaction of all these things is not there. So I think, therefore, intersectionality adds a further layer to the way you have to look at things.
Yeah, from a practical perspective of somebody who engages with policymakers and implements programs, I have looked at research that considers social determinants, but in constructing the response, which is so complex, it was very useful to have intersectionality research actually tell the complete story, especially when I was programming in a particular area. And I think that in terms of the time constraints and resource constraints we have as policymakers and implementers, it really adds value to have access to intersectional research that brings it all together for us.
Thank you. We've got some questions at microphone two. We'll in fact take questions from two people at a time and then do it that way.
Okay, my name's Fran Baum from Flinders University in Australia and also from the Steering Council of the People's Health Movement. I was also a commissioner on the Commission on the Social Determinants of Health. Seems to me that we're sort of missing a big bit of the debate about what drives inequities. Social determinants is a useful framework, and I think the Commission's report raised a lot of structural issues. Intersectionality is a tool for understanding things. But what we're not talking about is what's driving all the health inequities, which it seems to me is an extraordinarily economic system under neoliberalism that is really forcing us to live in a world that has extreme and growing inequities. So whether we use intersectionality or social determinants of health, we actually have to question what's an alternative economic system? How are we going to disrupt neoliberalism? How is neoliberalism driving inequities? And that seems to me the fundamental analysis that we need to do. And I think both approaches are useful in unpacking that if you start from a political economy of health perspective and use frameworks that Marxist frameworks and others that start with that kind of means of production and show how it leads to particular class relations, shows how it affects gender and all these other concerns, disability, how colonial histories have affected indigenous peoples. So I think much more attention to that kind of economic base, to the system that's driving that. And if people want to hear more about that, the People's Health Movement will be looking at it in a session at 4 o'clock in room 10 this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you, Fran.
I'm Dr. Gunjan from India, and this is something really very interesting. Now, my quick submission is that have we any sort of evidence on the role the concept plays at the level of the policy makers? So we have different vertical ministries, let us say, and they hardly talk to each other. So possibly the concept needs to start flowing from the top, and is there any evidence at a country level where something of this sort has started? Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, we'll pause there and deal with the first two questions. In fact, can I direct Fran Baum's question about missing the drivers of inequities? Can I ask Saira and Asha to sort of kick off with that one?
I think for me, the economic models, the political economy of health is a vital part of both the social determinants of health, but also an intersectional perspective. And a lot of what Syra presented, but also what Jean-Frédéric presented, was looking at the social context, but also the policy drivers and the macro global context, whether it's economics and how trade, legislation, a whole number of drivers influence health and our response as health systems. I think other participants will be able to talk also about the economic basis is critical, but it's experienced differently by different populations. And I think what we're arguing for is not that economics, the economic drivers, the structural drivers are not important, but we need a more sophisticated understanding. Those structural drivers are experienced by people in the system differently. And we need a better understanding of how the social location of people really affects how they experience those structural drivers. I don't think we're saying that those structural drivers are not important. It's a key part of this perspective.
Thank you for the question. I'm so glad to hear it. It's something that's not said in the same sentence in polite society often, you know, Marxism and neoliberalism. But I think for me, the question really is where to from here, and how do you build commitment and openness and the comfort levels in order to start engaging with very scary questions, despite the contradictions that are in front of us, because we talk about universal access to public healthcare without really examining the private sector basis of health in many countries, and how it interacts and how it's going to provide solutions to those that most need it. So I'll be there at 4 o'clock. but I think it's, for me, it's really about opening up the conversation in more discussions about the need to look at the fundamental drivers, but also understanding that particularly since we've not really interacted with what the solution really looks like very often. And my colleagues were mentioning, like, for example, we're here in Canada, the amount of information available on how Canada itself manages its public health system, the interactions of the rest of the world with solutions that work is minimal. So opening up those opportunities for debate and talking about exactly how to begin addressing the structural drivers is really, I think, the way forward.
Anyone else?
Completely in agreement with the fact that, yes, it's neoliberal globalization that's driving it. And I, you know, as Asha said, we're looking at how it is affecting different groups of people differently and how to look at it in a context-specific way, and that's about it.
I couldn't agree more with Fran Baum's comment. And I think that it's very important to understand that political aspects when we look at the evolution of healthcare systems and how they will respond to the needs of different people as well, because the world is going to change tremendously and very quickly given new technological advances, exploration of new models of financing and delivering healthcare in different places. And if we don't understand this political aspect, then there might not be responses really to people that live at the intersection of various vulnerabilities. So I couldn't agree more, and I think it's important to put it back in that context for sure.
Okay, thanks. So People's Health Movement, room 10, 4 o'clock. And it sort of, I think that it leads quite nicely into the second question, which was around the role, how we engage with policymakers and the role of policymakers within intersectionality. And Elena, you seem to be the ideal person to start off with that.
Oh, it's relationship building. It takes a lot of time, and you truly have to start where people are at, because everybody's got their comfort zone in terms of the kind of work that they've done, the kinds of issues that they've prioritized, the kinds of lenses that they use. So it's really about finding where people are at and slowly bringing them to a different place. I call it incremental radicalism. and in doing that work too, you have to show examples, illustrations, the value added. It's not enough to talk concepts and theory, although those are important things. You actually have to show the difference that it makes, and you have to sometimes make an argument that the different evidence that this approach generates can be a matter of life and death. So it's efficient, it's effective, but it can also be a matter of life and death.
And in your engagement, do you find that some ministry policymakers are more open to it than other ministries?
I would say, you know, there is, what happens is it resonates with people when you say, you know, none of us lives in small little boxes. We can't be contained in little boxes. So why should we assume that this is an approach that we should be taking in policy? And people say, well, I can't deal with it. It's too complex. And I say, well, the world is complex and we have to start figuring out ways to deal with that complexity. And not thinking any one project is going to get it right, but building a new kind of evidence and a new way of thinking about things.
Dr. Gunjan's question is important, and I don't really have any evidence to offer, but being exposed to that construct seems to me to be giving some opportunities to provide to local policymakers and decision makers, as well as clinicians, a way to put back social disadvantage into some classic tools of planning. You know, for example, everybody's interested in a predictive modeling where we would predict who will become a high user of services. And we can do that just using, you know, comorbidities and health problems. Or we could try really to assess who's at this intersection at the moment, and therefore we need to plan for social services and other types of support to be planned as well. So really putting it back into that context. And I have to say that many decision makers at the local level are actually interested to try to better understand what are those social cultural attributes that will predict needs, and therefore they want to be responsive for it. So I don't know if it works for sure, but it seems to me to be giving an angle to provide new tools for decision makers and clinicians.
And you're the only one amongst us who actually is in government. Do you find pushback from government when you try and engage in these sort of policy conversations?
Well, it of course depends on the government and why they were elected. But even though there's variation, there's always a desire to better understand, and I'm cutting all the time, to better understand what are the key priority groups that, you know, somehow should be identified. And intersectionality enables to put back the majority into the equation sometimes. So it's not just the minorities in societies that might end up, you know, at the intersection and therefore for a while be really vulnerable. And again, enable ministries and local governments to better plan and have better tools to identify those population and not just the minority groups is extremely important.
Okay, the next person, none of the other microphones? No, yes.
Silacha, I'm regional director for AMREF in West Africa. Other African organization working with community for more than 50 years, we are really interested in the question of community health workers. And next year we'll be launching a global campaign for community health workers. And my question is, which role or contribution do we see for intersectionality research to get or to have in our country sustainable CHW program that are well integrated into the health system? Thanks.
Thank you.
EK here from the Chinese University of Hong Kong, School of Public Health. I'd like to ask a question relating to the very insightful presentations from India about the not just the systems interactions, but the individual interaction level and actions, the processes. As you demonstrated, the individual's interactions are a very important component of this. So how does one deal with this, both in the context of informing policies, when there are these complexities of the interactions between individuals which use the services, between the individuals, the patients that seek services, and the people that provide it? Because each of those individuals will be acting differently from different policy perspectives. Even the same policy, in reality, will have different impacts on those individuals. So the individual level will be something that one has to grapple with, both in terms of the effects of policies and the effects of these interactions.
Thank you. I'm going to reverse the order of answering the questions because I will lose that one in my mind. So, Sundri, do you want to have a stab at it?
Well, in terms of keeping in mind the, how do you make policies keeping in mind all these complexities? Practically, all I would say is factor in how it would affect those that are going to be most affected and make sure that the policies are, you know, in a way that will not do that. So it's not that we are making different policies for different individuals, but that you take into account the needs of those that may get left out, or, you know, who would have the greatest difficulty in accessing or the greatest problems in terms of appropriateness of those services and so on. So keep that in mind is one of the things. And second, make no assumptions about broad categories. Not all well-to-do are really, you know, with access to all kinds of resources. And these kind of two categorization of, say, in India, below and above poverty line, forgets that there are so many on the margin, just sitting above the poverty line, who might, you know, I mean, face tremendous disadvantages because of ethnicity, because of gender, and because of various other axes. So,
anyone else?
In responding to the question about how do we create sustainable community health worker programs, what's the role of intersectionality? I think a key part of that is looking more critically at how do we create knowledge production to inform and develop those programs. Who's driving the research agenda? Who's involved? What are the partnerships we're brokering? And how does that influence what's a research priority? And how can that influence how programs evolve? And it is an investment in the health system, but also in communities. So it also means developing partnerships with communities themselves. Who are the people who are demanding or need services? What are their perspectives? And who are the people in communities? Who do they want as community health workers? And what are the perspectives of those community health workers? We've had a lot of research looking at what can community health workers do for programs, but I think we need a better understanding of how community health workers are embedded in communities, but also part of the larger health system, the integration into health service systems. But it's they're at the boundary, and we need to go beyond how effective are they for specific programs to see how are they important actors for both communities as well as the health systems they work for.
Just in answer to the question about, you know, how do we communicate that to the policymakers? In my experience, you know, the policies that are categorical are useful when your interaction with the target group is finite. Within the hospital, as soon as they leave the hospital, they are no longer your responsibility. So each ministry will say, this is my jurisdiction, and this is all I need to care about, because that's what I've been allocated, and somebody else will be responsible for another physical location after they leave the hospital. And in engaging with policymakers, it has been a sense of relief when you say that it doesn't end there, and you can actually follow them back and follow them back in and actually look at the interactions that happen all along the way to and fro, because it actually makes them more effective in that space where they see their mandate. So I think that intersectionality allows people to perceive the responsibility they bear in a more holistic way rather than in a more finite way. And as much as that may receive resistance in the beginning, ultimately there is relief.
Okay.
Hi, Karen Daniels from the South African Medical Research Council. I think that our discussion about intersectionality has so far quite fully embraced intersections of marginalization and intersections of vulnerability, but what we're not talking about is our intersections as health policy and systems researchers and intersections of advantage and the way that those blind us and in such a way that we do not see other intersections of vulnerabilities. And so particularly issues where we're seeing from our own lens of our own intersections, we are not seeing others, not seeing intersections around, for example, at the symposium, we're not hearing the voice of transgendered people. We're not hearing how health systems are excluding, particularly people who embrace a non-binary identity and are excluded from our spaces. And I think that the challenge, therefore, is for us to start embracing the broader spectrum and the, well, firstly, our own advantage, our own privilege, and starting to see that, you know, what are the voices that are excluded? What are the intersections that we're not yet talking about? Thanks.
Thank you.
Stephen Birch, McMaster University, Canada. I'm pleased the final speaker identified planning as one of the issues here and has brought us back to that a couple of times during the discussion. I think part of our problem is while policies rapidly advance and change in a dynamic environment, our planning mechanisms are stuck in the last century. And we need to get some innovation in our planning models to make sure that they become much more needs-based as opposed to supply-driven and supply-based, which they essentially are. And I think that's a key factor in trying to update our models and our systems that will allow us to deal with the issues we've been talking about today. Even at a very micro level, if we think about some of the things like the increase in mobilization of populations, the sort of frustrations that happen on the ground, both amongst providers and populations, is, for example, a primary care physician who has to fire a practice nurse because she or he now has to employ two or three interpreters. And there's nothing in the planning system that allows you to reflect that just a minute, with this change in population dynamics, we now need to provide interpretation services for that service. And instead, the provider on the ground, if they're going to do that, has to actually reduce the capacity to deliver care within that practice. So until we start to adopt a needs-based focus, a population focus to our planning, I think we're always going to have these tensions, which are often described as, but I don't think they genuinely reflect, sort of racist or sexist attitudes, the frustrations out of our planning systems not being responsive to our policies.
Thank you very much. There's a bit of meat on both those questions. So if we start with the notion that as researchers, we bring our own blindness to the problem and therefore miss some of the intersections.
It's true. I mean, those are good comments. We agree with it.
We agree.
I think we completely agree, but I think it comes to the most critical thing for me is what Sundri also said is, what are our assumptions of who is included? And being more reflective of that, but also having monitoring systems, forums, ways of engaging so that we don't assume we know all the answers. Because I think the other thing that I'm reflecting on is how some of who is marginalized, it's not necessarily a fixed population. And so there are key marginalized populations, our own biases hide who they are, but also the dynamics of the power drivers of inequality in our society means that the experience of disadvantage and the drivers of that can marginalize. Some marginalized populations have been marginalized for a long time, but there are also, our economies are changing, the politics in our societies are changing, and there are groups that their positions are changing. And I think of reflecting on caste in India, I know it's a sensitive topic, but it is something. There's historical disadvantage, but we can't assume that that experience of caste has stayed frozen in time. It hasn't. So it's an active inquiry to test our assumptions and to be open to looking at, constantly learning and learning to institute change.
That's why we need a framework. You know, it's not just to have a structured approach to writing a paper. It's also to keep our minds open to things that we wouldn't naturally be looking at. And really personally, I think it helps me to see epidemiology a bit differently. You know, and if I don't ignore the intersectionality framework, then I will not maybe as much influenced by, or at least I will not ignore completely in my assessment some of the key things that might be different than me, but also different from the assumptions that I had about who's disadvantaged and why. So it's extremely useful to embed into any approach, really, because it helps to see the, you know, quantitative variables or qualitative classification categories in a different light.
And while you're talking, do you want to pick up on the planning issues around intersectionality? Nope, you've lost your mic.
What happened to the mic?
Do you want to?
Yeah.
Oh, no, you've got your mic.
Sorry? Oh,
now you're
on. It's back. All right. Thank you for the comment. I think it's very important to remind ourselves that health services need to be planned on the basis of needs, on the basis of population characteristics. And if we are to really be able to take into account those intersections and the most vulnerable at specific times, then we need to start to measure it. You know, and to take the example of other sexual orientation, as mentioned by the previous question, you know, it's important to create questions that identify those in surveys, in data sets, etc., if you want to unearth any of those issues. So I don't think at the moment we can really do this with the data sets that we have in very advanced, you know, systems in terms of health information. So it is really something that should be on the agenda in developing those new systems with new technologies as well. But again, if we don't measure it, it's going to be very difficult to be able to grasp it in a monitoring and planning perspective.
Do you have
the rest of the question?
No.
Thank you. Anyway, I'm Asmat Mali from Pakistan. I'm an independent consultant. Besides that, I'm also co-chair of the Emerging Voices. We have debated around intersectionality, that the underlying factors are deeply rooted in political in political economy. What I see from the discourses or the debates that we are having here, that the health researchers have already started positioning themselves against the most recent popular mandates that were given to bring the change in the status quo, be it Brexit or be it the US elections. Don't you think that by taking this fixed stance or this biased stance that sounds to me as a bias, we have started creating an environment of fear and potential gloom? And what do you think? In what ways this fixed or biased stance will affect the future research on intersectionality, or using this lens to explore what are the reasons within the broader political economy? Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks. I'm from London School of Hygiene and Tropicalism and Peking University. Like Asmat, I'm also from the Emerging Voices Initiative. I guess I'm asking a question on behalf of the young researchers. We've found a lot of pressure in an early career that you have to publish. In order to publish, you better fit into a disciplinary requirement. So I think there's enormous challenge in practicing intersectionality from early career. And could you please share some of your perspectives on that? Thank you.
Thank you very much. I am very sorry to the last two people that are standing up for questions, but we're going to finish on these two questions, and you can carry on if you can catch us afterwards. I'm sorry about that. Can I pass on the global challenges affecting intersectionality?
The global challenges?
Well, sorry, the first question about the biases that are occurring and how that's going to affect intersectionality. No, you'll have to speak.
So you have to answer it.
I think so.
I'm deaf as a doorpost. I'm sorry, Sundri. Just say it.
We were saying you have to answer it.
I have to answer it.
Yes. You brought it up first.
Okay, fair enough. I think, I think it is an extremely challenging problem because we are in a room full of people that generally have a particular view about the shoulds and oughts of the world and how goods ought to be distributed. But then you take someone like Sarah's example of the Bao Zhao Lao, and I can tell you that none of the governments want to take responsibility for this group of people. So as a policy perspective, governments are increasingly wanting to say who the populations are they care about and who the populations are they don't care about. And I think it is up to us to push back and say that it has to be more inclusive. But this is in a world that the borders seem to be going up. So it's going to be an extremely challenging time.
Just one point on that. I think that there's going to be challenges in the measurement that are happening in different countries because some people are elected on the basis that they don't believe in this inequity analysis, and therefore they might want to take away the measurement. And this has happened in the Canadian context recently, and we always need to be very vigilant so that we keep those measurements there and be able to provide evidence to the debate from whichever political point of view we're coming from.
So, sorry, if I can just, now that you passed it to me, there's an interesting example around the measurement in Malaysia. The decisions by the Bureau of Statistics about how to measure ethnicity have changed markedly over time, and depending how you count your ethnicity shows that you are or are not achieving your MDG goals. So if you can subsume certain groups into other groups, then your MDG goals are achieved. And if they're separated, then in some groups, they're not achieved. It's a fascinating problem. Sorry.
I just wanted to make a comment to the young researcher
and not to
be discouraged. I think 10 years ago, when we started to talk about intersectionality in research and policy, it was very, very difficult. The funding was difficult, the publication was very difficult, but now I think you see across top peer-reviewed journals, top funding agencies, a willingness to actually engage with intersectionality. So if there's a pressure to do your work in a particular way, maybe in early stages you have a bit of a parallel track and do the things that you think you need to do in order to build your career, but at the same time, there is that room to experiment and move in the directions of intersectionality and know that your career will be enhanced if you're on the cutting edge, ultimately.
Sorry?
Yeah, the question before the young researcher about the move towards the right and what it means for intersectionality, I think it's timely and it's also a great opportunity because working only amongst the marginalized has marginalized the majority in ways that we didn't anticipate. And the work of intersectionality actually allows us to have a valid political perspective to engage with the majority so that we're not just dabbling at the edges, but we're moving society forward as a whole.
Asha.
I think we also need to interrogate the incentive structures in our research communities. And is your worth as a researcher, a young researcher, only based on the merit of publications? What kind of publications, what kind of engagement with communities, the topics we're interested in? So is it only scientific research studies of a certain type, or is it also engaging in commentaries or other forms of knowledge production that might not even be a publication? But that means a rethinking of how we engage as universities with the health systems around us and what are the incentive structures that shape people in that environment.
I think there's a need to challenge the hierarchies of what counts as evidence, what's good science, what is publishable, and so on, you know, and I think that is already starting and needs to move forward. I think the younger generation could take a few risks in terms of publishing also things that are not, you know, considered by maybe within their institutions rigorous science, and over time prove that what they have done is much more useful on the ground and is being validated by, yeah.
Thank you.
And on that, we will end. I'd just like to thank Elena, Sundri, Syrah, Asha, Jean-Frédéric for having done what we asked. So thank you very much.